In this videotape, we're going to learn how to sketch the graphs of polynomial functions. Say we want to sketch the graph of y equals f of x, where f is a polynomial. The key to doing this is to carefully analyze the first and second derivatives of f. Carefully analyze f prime of x and f double prime of x. Now, when we analyze it, what are we looking for? Well, if f prime of x, if f prime of x is positive, we learn that when the first derivative is positive, this implies that the function f is increasing. And where f prime of x is negative, this implies that the function f is decreasing. And what if f prime of x is 0 or does not exist? This would lead to a possible, only a possible at this stage, local max or min. Now, I said we're going to only work with polynomial functions. In general, when you're analyzing it for a general function, you'd care about where the derivative is positive, negative, where it's zero, or does not exist. Since we're talking about polynomials, we don't have to worry about it not existing, because polynomials are everywhere differentiable. So basically, as long as we're sticking with polynomials in this videotape, we're going to be concerned with where the derivative is positive, where it's negative, and where it's zero. Okay? After we've done that, we're going to go on and look at the second derivative and repeat the analysis. If the second derivative is positive, then the graph of the function is going to be concave up. Function is concave up at that point. If the second derivative is negative, the function is concave down. And if the second derivative is 0 or does not exist, once again, the does not exist possibility is not occurring in this tape, but just to keep it in mind, in either of those cases, we have a possibility of a point of inflection. So analyzing the first and second derivative is going to give us a lot of information. We're going to analyze the first derivative completely. And where it's positive, negative, or zero, it's going to give us important information. Same kind of analysis on the second derivative, except the answers are going to be different. First derivative is positive, the function's increasing. If the second derivative is positive, the curve is concave up. Now, some students confuse the concept of increasing, decreasing with concave up and concave down. It's important to realize that a function can be increasing and either concave up or concave down. Let's look at some pictures. Okay, if a portion of the curve looks like this, here the function is increasing and concave up. Increasing, because as we move from left to right, the y values are increasing. Concave up, because if we were to draw in a tangent line, the curve is above its tangent line. Or some books say the curve, if you thought of it as like a cup, would hold water if it's concave up. So the function can be increasing and concave up. However, the function could also be increasing and concave down. This is an example of a function that's increasing and concave down. It is increasing as we move from left to right. The y values are increasing. But now, if we were to draw in the tangent lines, the curve is below its tangent line. Once again, this concave up curve would sort of hold water. The concave down curve, if it were a cup, would spill the water out. But do not feel that if a curve is increasing, it has to be concave up. You can see it can increase either concave up or concave down. And similarly, it can decrease either concave up or concave down. So here we have a function which is decreasing, d decreasing, and concave up. Because as we move from left to right, the y values are decreasing, but it is concave up. It is still above its tangent line. And we have an example of a function that's decreasing and concave down. The y values are decreasing as you move from left to right, and the curve is below its tangent line. Well, once again, this curve would hold water, this curve would spill water. Okay, so don't confuse the two ideas. Increasing can be, a curve that's increasing can go either concave up or concave down, and similarly a curve that's decreasing. Now, it is important that we do have an understanding of concavity. If I tell you that a function has a minimum at the origin, okay, it makes a difference. Knowing the function has a minimum at the origin is not enough. This function could be concave up and have a minimum at the origin, or it could be concave down and have a minimum at the origin. Okay. This curve is decreasing and then increasing to give us a minimum. This curve is also decreasing and then increasing to give us a minimum. Of course, this is a polynomial. For example, y equals x squared. This is not the graph of a polynomial. We have a point here where the function is not differentiable, and this could be the graph of the function y equals x to the 2/3. Now, we're not going to be concerning ourselves with anything other than polynomials in this videotape, but I just wanted to mention the idea that knowing that a function has a minimum at a particular point is not enough. Some concept of the concavity is useful if you're going to try to sketch the graph of the function. Okay, let's try to use this idea of analyzing the first and second derivatives on a particular example. Let's sketch the graph of the function y or f of x equals x cubed minus 6x squared plus 9x plus 6. Okay, and being careful to indicate all local maxima and minima all points of inflection and the intervals where the curve is increasing, decreasing, concave up, and concave down. This is your typical question for curve sketching for polynomial. Sketch the graph of this function, being careful to indicate all local maxima, minima, points of inflection, intervals where the curve is increasing, decreasing, concave up, and concave down. Okay, let's find our first derivative, f prime of x. That's 3x squared minus 12x plus 9, taking the derivative of y with respect to x. And our second derivative is the derivative of our first derivative with respect to x, 6x minus 12. And now we're going to analyze these derivatives. Remember what we're trying to find out. We're looking, for example, where the first derivative is positive. That's where the function's increasing. Where it's negative, it's decreasing. Where it's zero, we don't have to worry about it not existing because it's a polynomial. Where it's zero would be a possible local max or min. And then later on, we'll do the same analysis on the second derivative, the same work, except the conclusions will be different. Okay, so let's look at our first derivative. Three x squared minus 12x plus 9. Now I'm interested in where this is positive and negative. What I'm going to do is first figure out where it's equal to zero. It's a continuous function. Okay, if I could figure out where it's going to be zero, okay, I have a pretty good idea of where it's positive and negative. Remember, a continuous function can't go from being positive to negative without passing through zero. It can't go from one level to another level without passing through every level in between. Similarly, it can't go from negative to positive without passing through zero. If I start off by finding all the places where it's zero, I'll be on the right track. Okay, we want to solve this equation. We can factor out a 3 times x squared minus 4x plus 3. 3x squared minus 12x plus 9. And here we have a trinomial that factors nicely into two binomials, looking for two numbers that multiply to plus 3 and add to minus 4, say minus 1 and minus 3. Let's check this. X squared minus 3x minus 1x minus 4x plus 3. Okay, we can divide both sides by 3. We have x minus 1 times x minus 3 is 0. Either x minus 1 is 0 or x minus 3 is 0. Two possible answers, x equals 1, x equals 3. I recommend at this point figuring out what the y values are. These eventually are these probably are going to be important points for us in our curve sketching. So as soon as we've found these x values, I'm going to substitute in, remember that I'm substituting into the original equation, the y equals form, okay, to get what y is. If x is 1, y, or f of x, it's 1 minus 6 plus 9 plus 6. 1 minus 6 plus 9 plus 6, the 6's cancel out. 1 plus 9, if x is 1, y is 10. If x is 3, once again, back to the original equation, x is 3, we get 3 cubed 27 minus 6 times 9 minus 54 plus 27 plus 6. 27 and 27, that's 54, minus 54, that's 0, plus 6. So we have 3, 6. Now, make yourself a chart that has x and f prime of x in its columns. I want you to take these critical numbers. When we set the first derivative equal to 0, we found these critical numbers for the first derivative. We have here locations of possible local max and minima. So I want you to take your critical numbers 1 and 3 and arrange them in ascending order. In other words, from lowest to highest in the x side of the table. Now, these two critical numbers break up the number line into three intervals, namely x less than 1, x between 1 and 3, and x greater than 3. If you have trouble doing it vertically, you can visualize it this way. If this is 1 and this is 3, the intervals are x less than 1, x between 1 and 3, and x greater than 3. These two critical numbers break up the real number line into three intervals. Now, what I want you to do is to pick a testing value in each of these intervals. I'm interested in some number less than 1. Any number will do. You can use 0, you can use minus 1, whatever. Anything less than 1. I'm looking now for a number between 1 and 3. For example, 2. Any number greater than 3. You could use 4, you could use 5. I don't want you to feel you have to use the next number. And I'm going to figure out the sign of f prime of x at each of these numbers. I already know that f prime of x is 0 at 1 and 3. In other words, to plug x equal to 1 into f prime of x. Remember, when you see f prime of x, you have to substitute it into the f prime of x equation. Over here you had y, you substitute it into the y equals. Here f prime of x, you're substituting into the f prime of x. If I substitute x equals 1, of course, I get 3 and 9, 12 minus 12 is 0. Similarly, if I substitute in 3. By the way, the factored form might be more convenient for you. Substitute 1 or 3, obviously it's going to be 0. Now what if you substitute in x equals 0? You can use either this form and get 9, or you can go over here, 3 times minus 1 times minus 3, and that's also 9. The important thing, however, it's positive. Now let's try x equals 2. I'm only interested, when I say f prime of x, I'm really only interested in the sign of f prime of x. If I plug in x equals 2, 3 times 2 minus 1 times 2 minus 3. 3, 2 minus 1 is positive, 2 minus 3 is negative. Positive, positive, negative. The product, positive, positive, negative, must be negative. You can figure out the actual number, but it's not necessary. Just the sign. Substituting in 3, of course, you got 0. Substituting in 5, you get 3. 5 minus 1 is positive. 5 minus 3 is positive. Positive times positive times positive. The result is positive. Okay, now we can interpret the results that we've found here. Now, I claim at 0, the first derivative was positive. This leads me to conclude that the function is increasing throughout the interval x less than 1. And you might say, well, how do I know it's increasing whenever x is less than 1? All you showed me that is at 0, the first derivative was positive. How do I know that, for example, at minus 1, it's not going to be negative? Remember, it's a continuous function. Continuous function can't go from positive to negative without passing through every level in between. So if it was positive and if it was going to turn negative, it would have to pass through 0. But we started by first finding out every place where the derivative was 0. So I can feel pretty safe in saying that it's positive here at 0. It's also positive at minus 1, minus 2, minus 7, minus 20. Throughout the interval less than 1, the first derivative is positive and the function is increasing. Because it has to stay positive. The only other choice would be to turn to 0, which it can't because we found the zeros first, or negative, and it can't turn to negative unless it first turns to 0 for a continuous function. So this decision that the function is increasing applies not only to 0, but throughout the interval x less than 1. Similarly, at 2, the first derivative was negative, so the function is decreasing. But it's decreasing not only at 2, but throughout the interval between 1 and 3. And finally here at 5, the first derivative is positive again, so the function is increasing. Once again, the increasing applies throughout the interval greater than 3. Now, if prior to this critical number, the function is increasing, and after it's decreasing, the function is increasing and then decreasing, that tells me that at 1, I have, in fact, location of a local maxima. The first derivative has changed sign from plus to minus. That indicates a local maximum because the function was increasing and then decreasing, giving me, at 1, the top of a hill. Now, let's look at this point at 3. Prior to this critical number, the function is decreasing, and then it's increasing. The function is decreasing and then increasing. I have a valley there. So I have a local minimum occurring when x equals 3. So I can now interpret my points here. When x equals 1, we had a local maximum. I'm going to use big M to indicate a maximum. When x was equal to 3, I had a minimum. I'm going to use little m to indicate the minimum. So I now know I've done half my problem. I know where the function is increasing, where it's decreasing, and I have found my max and minimum points. Now, if we go back over here, by analyzing the second derivative the same way I analyzed the first derivative, I am going to be able to find out about concavity and points of inflection. If the second derivative now will be positive, when the first derivative was positive, the function was increasing. When the second derivative is positive, the curve will be concave up. When the first derivative was negative, the function was decreasing. When the second derivative is negative, the function's concave down. And just like when the first derivative was 0, you might have had a point, local max or min. Now, when the second derivative is 0, you may have a point of inflection. By the way, when I say you may have like a max or a min, If, for example, the sign did not change here, if the function was increasing and still increasing, we'll see that in a later example, then it's not a max and it's not a min. Or if it was decreasing and stayed decreasing. In order for there to be a max or a min, there has to be a sign change in the first derivative. If it changes from plus to minus, it's a max. If it changes from minus to plus, it's a min. Okay, now I want to repeat everything I did for the first derivative, but now I want to do it for the second derivative. My second derivative was 6x minus 12. I set the second derivative equal to 0. 6x equals 12, dividing by 6, x equals 2. Possible location of a point of inflection. I immediately want to get the y value for that. Remember, to get the y value, you have to go back to the original y equals equation. There are a lot of equations on the board. You have for f of x, f prime of x, f double prime of x. It's important to know which one to substitute in at all times. Here, if I want a y value, I go to the y equals equation. When x equals 2, y is equal to 2 cubed, 8 minus 6 times 2 squared minus 6 times 4 minus 24 plus 18, 9 times 2 plus 6. Well, 18 and 6 is 24, and minus 24, that gives you 0. 2 cubed is 8. So if x is 2, y is 8. I only have one possible point of inflection. And just like I made a chart with x against f double prime of x, x against f prime of x, now I'm going to make a chart with x against f double prime of x. Now, as many points I get from setting my second derivative equal to 0, I would arrange them in ascending order in my table. Of course, I only got one point. This one point will divide my number line into two intervals, 1x less than 2 and 1x greater than 2. I will look for any testing value less than 2, for example, 0, any testing value greater than 2, let's say 4. And I'm interested in the sign of the second derivative. The second derivative, of course, is here. If I substitute in x equals 0, 0 minus 12, it's negative. If I plug in the 2, of course, it comes out to be 0. If I plug in the 4, 6 times 4, 24 minus 12 is positive. Now, my interpretation. If the second derivative is negative, that tells me the curve is concave down. If the second derivative is positive, it tells me the curve is concave up. So the curve is concave up whenever x is greater than 2. It is concave down whenever x is less than 2. At 2, the curve changes direction of concavity. A sign change, either from minus to plus or plus to minus, indicates that at x equals 2, we do, in fact, have a point of inflection. So I might label this point 2,8 with an I to indicate that it's a point of inflection. Now, remember, in the first derivative chart, the type of sign change was important. From plus to minus, you had a max. From minus to plus, you had a min. Okay? In the second derivative sign chart, we do not distinguish. Whether it changes from minus to plus or plus to minus, we just call it a point of inflection. Okay, now let's put everything that we have together to actually sketch the graph of the function. Let's see if I can... I'll put it in here. Step one is to put on your graph to plot any of the points that you have labeled. We have big M, little m, and I, the max, the min, and the point of inflection. So I want to plot 110, 36, and 28. I don't have to write in 110, I just have to write big M. That'll help me remember what it is. That's the max. I have 3, 6. That's little m for my min. And 2, 8. For my point of inflection. Now, if you didn't have this calculus behind you, you might mistakenly think, oh, let me draw a straight line. But we understand a lot of things about what's going on here, where the function's increasing, decreasing, concave up and concave down, and we're going to use this all to sketch the graph of the function properly. By the way, if you want to have another point might be useful to you, the y-intercept is easy enough to get. If x is 0, y is 6. It'll give me some idea of how wide to draw this. X is 0, y is 6. Just so that I know how to cross the y-axis when I'm drawing it. Okay. Now, to sketch the graph of the function, always start from your second derivative chart. When x is less than 2, I want you to draw the curve concave down. When x is greater than 2, 2 remember is our point of inflection, I want to draw the curve concave up. The best place to start is from your point of inflection and your second derivative chart. So remember, x is less than 2, the curve should be concave down. X is greater than 2, it should be concave up. So, when x is less than 2, or to the left of the point of inflection, I'm going to draw the curve concave down and pick up the maximum while I do that. When x is greater than 2, to the right of the point of inflection, I'm going to draw the curve concave up and pick up the minimum. And there I have the graph of the function. Let's see if it makes sense. The curve was supposed to be increasing prior to the max, then decreasing, then increasing. Remember, increasing, decreasing, then increasing. This follows. It's increasing less than 1, decreasing between 1 and 3, and then increasing. That gave us the max and min. Furthermore, to the left of the point of inflection, the curve was concave down. To the right of the point of inflection, the curve was concave up. So we've put all this information together to sketch the graph of this function. Okay, for our next example, I'm going to sketch the graph of f of x equals x to the fourth plus 4x cubed minus 2, being careful to indicate, once again, all local max and minimum, all points of inflection, intervals where the curve is increasing, decreasing, concave up, and concave down. Okay, so this is the problem we want to work out. Just like we did before, we're going to start by finding f prime of x, the derivative of f of x with respect to x, which is 4x cubed plus 12x squared, and f double prime of x, I'm going to write it up over here, which is the derivative of f prime of x with respect to x, that's 12x squared plus 24x. These are polynomials. I assume there's no problem in getting these derivatives. So 4x cubed plus 12x squared for the first derivative, 12x squared plus 24x for the second derivative. And now we're going to analyze them completely. We want to figure out where the first derivative is positive, negative, 0. We don't have to worry about it not existing. Once again, it's a polynomial, and polynomials are everywhere differentiable, so the derivative will always exist. In order to do that, we're going to set the first derivative equal to 0. The easiest way to do that is to first factor this, 4x squared times x plus 3, and set it equal to 0, giving us two critical numbers, x equals 0 and x equals minus 3. Whereas we're letting 4x squared be 0 and x plus 3 equals 0 to get those two critical numbers. Immediately, we want to get the y values that go with these x values. To get the y values, we're going to be plugging into the y equals equation. Okay, always have to remember, are you plugging into f prime of x, are you plugging into f double prime, are you plugging into y or f of x? Here we're plugging into y or f of x. If x is 0, y is 0 plus 0 minus 2. And if x is minus 3, minus 3 to the 4th, that's 81, plus 4 times minus 3 cubed. Minus 3 cubed is minus 27, times 4 is minus 108, minus 2, that's 81 minus 110, or minus 29 for the y value. These are possible max or local max or min points. We don't know yet if they really are, in fact. We'll have to check it out. And the way we check it out is to make our first derivative chart, x against f prime of x, and we write down our critical numbers in ascending order from lowest to highest. So we don't write 0 and minus 3, but rather minus 3 first and then 0, because this is smaller. We're moving from lowest to highest. These two critical numbers divide the number line into three intervals. X less than minus 3, x between minus 3 and 0, and x greater than 0. And we're going to pick, as we did before, a testing value in each of these intervals, some value less than minus 3, for example, minus 4. Some value between minus 3 and 0, so for example, minus 1. Some value, any value greater than 0, for example, 2. And we're going to be interested in f prime of x, actually only its sign is really of importance to us, the sign of f prime of x. Now f prime of x, of course, when we want to get f prime of x, we're substituting in to the f prime of x equation. We can use the factored form, it's usually easier to substitute in there. Okay, if we substitute in x equals minus 4, we get 4 times minus 4 squared, which is certainly positive, minus 4 plus 3 is negative, positive times negative, it's negative. At minus 3, of course, we get a positive times 0, which is 0. We knew it was 0 there to start. At minus 1, we get 4 times minus 1 squared, which is positive. Minus 1 plus 3 is positive. Positive times positive is positive. At 0, 0 times 3, it's 0. We knew those were zeros. We started with these values for setting the second derivative equal to 0. Okay, and at x equal to 2, 4 times 2 squared, positive. 2 plus 3, positive. Positive times positive is positive. Now, the first derivative is negative when x is less than minus 3, so this one tells me that the function is decreasing when x is less than minus 3. And the first derivative is positive when x is between minus 3 and 0. That tells me the function is increasing between minus 3 and 0. And finally, the first derivative is still positive when x is greater than 0, which means the function continues to increase here. Now remember, a sign change in the first derivative is necessary to have a max or a min. Around minus 3, to the left, the function is decreasing, and then to the right, the function is increasing. The function went from decreasing to increasing, from decreasing to increasing, so we have a local min at minus 3. The function was decreasing before and then increasing after. The first derivative changed sign from minus to plus. Here, the first derivative does not change sign. The function is increasing and continuing to increase. So this is neither a max nor a min. So what do we have? We now know that at minus 3 we do have a min. We can use a little m. And at 0, we don't have a max or a min. So far we have just a min. Now we're going to repeat our analysis on the second derivative. We're going to once again factor 12x times x plus 2 and set the derivative equal to 0. Get 12x equals 0, giving us x equals 0. X plus 2 equals 0, giving us x equals minus 2. We want to get the y values. And we're once again substituting into the y equals equation. If x is 0, y is 0 plus 0 minus 2. If x is minus 2, substituting in here, minus 2 to the 4th, that's 16. Now, minus 2 cubed is minus 8 times 4 is minus 32, and then minus 2, 16 minus 34, or minus 18. And what we have here are possible points of inflection. Whether they really are points of inflection, we will not know until we make our second derivative chart. So we're going to go x against f double prime of x. And we're going to arrange our numbers that we got here by setting the second derivative equal to 0 in ascending order from lowest to highest. So minus 2 and then 0. By the way, you might recognize this point 0, minus 2. It tried to be a max or min here. It didn't make it. But now it's again trying to be a point of inflection. And this very often happens, that a point that did not qualify as either a max or a min, it was a neither here, very often these points come back and try again in the second derivative. Okay? These two values divide the number line into three intervals. X less than minus 2, x between minus 2 and 0, and x greater than 0. Any number less than minus 2, for example, minus 3, between minus 2 and 0, like minus 1, and greater than 0, 1, 2, anything you can use. We're interested once again in the sign of f double prime, the sign of the second derivative. You've got to keep it straight. Always substitute into the correct equation. Okay? The factored form is available and probably more convenient. We substitute in the minus 3. 12 times minus 3 is negative. Minus 3 plus 2 is negative. Negative times negative is positive. We substitute in the minus 2. We get negative times 0. But of course, we knew that was 0. Minus 1, negative 12, that's negative, times negative 1 plus 2 is positive. Negative times positive is negative. Plugging in 0, 0 times 2 is 0. Substituting in 2, 12 times 2, positive. 2 plus 2, positive, it's positive. This tells me that the curve is concave up here. Second derivative is positive. The curve is concave up when x is less than minus 2. Second derivative is negative. It's concave down here when x is between minus 2 and 0. And again, it's concave up when x is greater than 0. It has switched from concave up to concave down to concave up. The fact that there was a sign change, either plus to minus or minus to plus, around each of these points indicates that, yes, they are, in fact, points of inflection. So that's a point of inflection, and that is also a point of inflection. So we'll label this with an I and this with an I. So this curve has two points of inflection and a minimum. And now we're ready to try to sketch the graph of the function using the information that we got in these charts. Okay, we have the point 0, minus 2, let's see, minus 2, minus 18, and minus 3, minus 29 that we have to sketch. So, see, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Let's just pretend this is, say, minus 5, minus 10, minus 15, minus 20, minus 25, minus 30. These should really be a little closer together, but I want you to be able to see what's going on here. So I've changed the scale a little for the x and y axis. Okay, what do we have? We have 0, minus 2. It would be around here. That's a point of inflection. We have minus 2 minus 18. It's about here. That's another point of inflection. And minus 3 minus 29. It's around here. And this is a minimum. Once again, we start our curve sketching using the second derivative chart. We have two points of inflection. To the left of the first point of inflection, this is minus 2. To the left of the first point of inflection, when x is less than minus 2, I want you to draw the curve concave up. To the left of the first point of inflection here, moving from left to right, draw the curve concave up, of course, picking up the minimum on the way. Not exactly sure what the x-intercept is there, but we're not going to worry too much about it. Then between the two points of inflection, between minus 2 and 0, draw the curve concave down. Okay, draw the curve concave down. And then to the right of this point of inflection, again, draw the curve concave up. Now, we have to do a little bit more work to figure out exactly what the x-intercepts are. But what I'm trying to get here is the idea of increasing, decreasing, and concave up. Let's see if I can make this a little smoother here to indicate the concave up nature. Second. Okay. Concave up to the first point of inflection, concave down between the points of inflection, then concave up. If you were to join the tangent line, the curve is above the tangent line here, below its tangent line here, above its tangent line here. Holds water, spills water, holds water. Now, as far as increasing and decreasing, remember, to the left of minus 3, the curve was decreasing. And then it was increasing between minus 3 and 0, and then it continued to increase. And this is what this reflects. We have the curve decreasing up until minus 3. Between minus 3 and 0, it was increasing. Part of the time it was increasing concave up, and the other part of the time it was increasing concave down, but it was increasing. And then it continued to increase. So we have a minimum and two points of inflection. And that brings us to the end of this tape.